Good morning, church, and welcome to OKC First on this Mother's Day weekend. We are so excited to have everyone joining us online today, and especially to celebrate the women of our lives, but also to celebrate also on this day our graduating seniors, our graduating high school seniors. This is our senior celebration Sunday. One of the many consequences of this COVID-19 crisis is that we don't get to celebrate with our seniors in person. There's a lot of lost time and relationship, friendship, all the end of the year stuff that goes along with being a senior in high school. And for that, we're heartbroken for all of our seniors. But today we want to take a little bit of time out of our service, as we usually do every year, to celebrate, to recognize all who are graduating this year. Our former youth pastor, Mike Laughlin, and myself have gotten to watch these students grow up. We've gotten to watch them journey through life and faith together. We are excited to celebrate with all of you today. And without further ado, let's start our senior slideshow.
darkness fades into new beginnings as we lift our eyes to a hope beyond. All creation waits with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our God. We will not be moved when the earth gives way.
Joining us again online today. There's something that I want to say up front, and that is God's mind about you is made up, and the news is good. And I think that I need to hear that sometimes as a mom in a pandemic. This is Mother's Day, and this isn't exactly what we want to do to celebrate our moms. Some of us are missing seeing our moms. Some of us became moms in pandemic like I did, and this has just been a hard season, but God is faithful, and God's people are faithful, and moms have been surrounded in the ways that they can be surrounded, and it is good. So I'm grateful for a Mother's Day in a pandemic. I'm grateful that we can celebrate each other in unique ways, and I hope that coming to church today is one of the ways that we can celebrate our moms. Now I want to read our scripture for our call to worship. The Lord is King. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He is girded with strength. He has established the world. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from old. You are from everlasting. That's from Psalm 93. Let's pray together. Dear God, I pray that you would be with us as we are sitting on our couches, as we are participating together separately in worship. Pray that we would feel your presence, God. In Jesus' name, amen. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath.
Your breath. His voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And it is well. It is well. So let go,
Speak, oh Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth planted deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Words of power that can never fail, let their truth prevail over unbelief.
Today's scripture comes from John chapter 14, verses 6 through 7. Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." This is the word of the Lord.
Welcome, everybody, to the fifth Sunday in the season of Easter and the fifth sermon in a series entitled Grace. We have been using the terminology of resurrection grace. We're going to use that again today. And we are also asking our photographers to get involved in the act. We have extended the deadline a couple of weeks. We've had somebody say, hey, we'd like to have another couple of weeks to get pictures in. And so we acquiesced. We're going to have another couple of weeks for you to get your pictures in. We've got 18 strong entries right now. So please send in those pictures of hope, those images of hope during a pandemic. We understand those to be images of resurrection hope during a pandemic, so please send those in to us as soon as you can, at least by May 25th. Send them into photo@okcfirst.com. I appreciate that. One of the biggest tragedies of this, of the timing of the pandemic, is that we are missing a lot of celebrations. Tamara spoke about it earlier today. This is supposed to be a different kind of Mother's Day today, but because of the pandemic, it is awfully different, right? And not in a great way. It is also graduation season, and we are missing graduations, at least for the time being, at least. We are missing all of those graduations. And maybe that's not all bad, because at least we're not having to see this. So maybe, like me, you look at a couple of those falls and you suspect that they may have been planned or staged. So maybe, actually, we are saving a couple of our graduates from embarrassing themselves. I'm looking at you, Colby Thompson and Ian Hancock. But we are also missing other sorts of celebrations, like Cinco de Mayo. We weren't able to go out and enjoy Cinco de Mayo like we would have otherwise. And Monday of this past week, May the 4th, was Star Wars Day. May the 4th, Star Wars Day. May the 4th be with you. Now, you know that it was a dad who said that the first time, right? May the 4th be with you. And that dad was incredibly pleased with himself when he said it, even though his teenage children were kind of clawing at their eyes because he said it. But you know it was a dad who said it the first time. It is actually understood also as Star Wars Day, when people like to dress up and they like to watch all of the movies and perhaps even like to watch some of the shows, maybe even like one of the more recent shows called The Mandalorian. The Mandalorian. Make that The Mandalorian. Pardon me. Speaking of dad jokes, The Mandalorian. We have actually watched such a show at our house as well, and we too have been taken with Baby Yoda. And I am struck as I read this passage of scripture today, believe it or not, I'm struck with the similarity of a line that is actually delivered several times in The Mandalorian, and here is that line.
This is the way.
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 So not exactly how the Mandalorian might mean it, but we're going to hear our Savior say something kind of similar later on. In fact, I kind of want that to be the refrain for this entire sermon. As you listen, be listening for the several different times that I try to punctuate the sermon with this line, this Jesus is the way. This Jesus is the way. Now, here's what I mean by all of that. This Jesus is the way. This Jesus is going to show us what this way of life is that Jesus specs out for all of us. This Jesus is going to also be the means of access to the very heart of God and to this kingdom life that we are all talking about so much. Love is actually going to be a word that you're going to hear a lot today as well. As a matter of fact, let me say this about love. I'm not sure that we fully appreciate the power of love. Now, yes, that is that's the title of a very popular song, but that's not quite what I mean here. What I want to say is this. We like to say around here all the time, we write it and we say it to one another, we say, love wins, love wins, love wins. But I'm afraid it's become cliche. I want us to lean into that phrase again, and I want us to say love, and not any kind of love, but a particular kind of love that is demonstrated by our Savior, by Jesus, by the Christ. That particular kind of love does animate and organize and win every single day. Doesn't mean there's not going to be struggles, but that kind of love wins every single day. Now, in order to give us some sort of idea of what this love looks like, we're going to have to go all the way back to chapter 13. So all the way back to chapter 13, verse 1. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end, or in some of your Bibles it may say this, he now showed them the full extent of his love. Now, this is the kind of love I'm talking about. This is the kind of love that I think we will understand to be at some point, someday, undefeated. This is the kind of love that we're going to be talking about throughout the rest of this sermon. This kind of love. This kind of love is the defining characteristic of our God. First and foremost, our God wants to be understood as love. This kind of love. By the way, it is first and foremost the defining characteristic of our Savior, this Christ. Before this Jesus is anything else, this Jesus is the embodiment of this special kind of love. And so, Christians, Christianity is a faith whose defining characteristic must be this kind of love. Love has to be, and this particular kind of love has to be our defining characteristic. And so Jesus is going to show them what this love looks like. And so you know the story. What Jesus does is he takes off his outer clothing and he wraps a towel around his waist and he takes a basin and he goes around and he actually takes the form of a servant, the lowest kind of servant. And this Jesus washes feet. This is an act of selfless, sacrificial love. And he washes each person's feet. Simon Peter says, no, I'm not going to have you wash my feet. And Jesus says, hang on a second. If I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. Simon Peter's response, as you know, is, well, wait a minute then, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. Now Simon Peter understands that this is a gesture of love, a gesture of intimacy, that Jesus is here strengthening, not only strengthening the definition of love, but strengthening the bond of love between Christ and all of these disciples. Important passage, important moment here. Now, after he had washed their feet, verse 12, and after he had put on his robe and had returned to the table, he said to them, do you get yet what I have done to you or for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that is what I am. And so now that I, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. And he says this, and he says it not just to the disciples, but also to us. I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done for you. Later on, as you know, Judas Iscariot is identified as the one who's going to betray Jesus, and he finally leaves the room. And it is night. It is dark. We've talked about that before this season. And then Jesus starts a speech that in my head lasts several chapters. It's right here at the end of chapter 13, but it lasts through 14, 15, and 16. And then in chapter 17, we have this very long prayer that Jesus prays for these people that he loves so dearly. And then in chapter 18 and 19, we have the arrests and the crucifixion. Verse 33 here. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you belong to me. Everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Now, Simon Peter is struggling. Simon Peter is troubled by this. He says, wait a minute, Jesus, you're going somewhere? Like, where? What is the address? Where are you going? And why can't we go with you? And Jesus answers him, now, you can't go with me. I've been saying this to you. You can't go with me right now. It's not like it's a location, destination kind of a place with an address. I'm going somewhere that you cannot go right now. And Simon Peter said, well, why not? I would lay down my life for you. And Jesus answered, will you really? Because really, what you're going to do is disown me three times before the morning. I imagine that that was a stunned silence in that room for a lot of different reasons. Perhaps, again, the disciples are concerned. Perhaps they are afraid. Perhaps they are upset. But perhaps also they recognize now that they don't recognize who this is. They have been calling Jesus someone special. They've been calling Jesus perhaps even a prophet. But had they completely wrapped their minds and hearts around Christ's identity? Do they really understand what it means to be standing here and listening to Jesus? The disciples still don't know who's in the room with them. Sure, they knew he was special, and the works themselves demonstrated that he had a special connection to God, but do they really know who he is? It doesn't seem that the disciples yet understand that his very presence in the world and now in the room as the incarnate word and all that he says and does reveals God to them and the essence and the nature and the mission of God to them in a brand new way. Now, the narrator of the Gospel of John, the author of the Gospel of John, he seems to know who this Jesus is. Keep in mind, that this gospel was the last gospel written, perhaps 50, perhaps 70, maybe even 90 years after the fact. And so in hindsight, they can look back on the words that Jesus said and start to make sense of them in ways that they couldn't in the days depicted in these words. The narrator makes sense of Jesus' words, his works, and his life, and he demonstrates both the challenge of belief, but also the immense possibilities of belief that exists even for us today. And so Jesus tries again to explain who he is, to show them his true identity. He says to them, still gathered there, don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. He says, in my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare this place for you? He said, and if I go to prepare this place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Now again, you can understand why Simon Peter and later Thomas will think that Jesus is talking about some sort of destination. But Jesus isn't talking about, again, a place with a mailing address. Maybe it would be easier for us had he not used this word house. If he says something more like this, in my Father's heart. And instead of many rooms, if he were to say, in my Father's heart, there are many places, many spaces. There is room for each of you. Now, perhaps you are troubled a little bit that I have taken the liberty of changing a few words in these verses, but you need to know I'm doing so given the rest of Scripture, given the rest of the New Testament, given the rest of the Gospel of John. Oftentimes, these words, home or house or dwell or dwelling, are used to indicate not a place that would have an address, a mailing address, but they are used to indicate relationship. They're used to indicate relationship, intimacy, closeness. And so when I say to you, maybe we can better hear this if we say, no, I'm going to my Father's heart. And what's going to happen through the death and the resurrection and the ascension is going to make space in that heart for all of us, for each of us, and for all of us. But still, Thomas doesn't understand. He still doesn't get it. And so Thomas says, Thomas, Lord, we don't even know where you're going. How can we know the way? How can we know the way to this place that you are going? Jesus perhaps was even frustrated at this point. Jesus says to him, okay, here's the thing. I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life. Everybody knows this verse, I think. No one comes to the Father except through me. Verse 7, if you know me, then you will know the Father also. And from now on, you do know him and have seen him, says Jesus. Now that verse 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There is a lot to unpack here. This is, in many commentators' opinion, this is the focal point of the entire Gospel of John. I am the way, the truth, and the life. But it is meant to shine a spotlight on Jesus. It is meant to shine a spotlight, even more specifically, on the connection between Jesus and God. Even more specifically than that, it is meant to shine a spotlight on the love that exists between Jesus and God, into which we will all be invited in very specific ways throughout the rest of this gospel. But instead, so many times, we use this verse like a weapon. And when we use this verse like a weapon, and when it doesn't have to do with the intimacy, with the love that is shared between Jesus and God and then with us, then we miss the point, not just of the verse, but perhaps the Gospel of John, perhaps of the gospel. Verse 8, Philip said to Jesus, Lord, still not getting it, Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. I think Jesus took a very deep breath that probably was a lot like a sigh. And Jesus said in verse 9, have I been with you all this time, Philip, and still you do not know me? And says as plainly as he knows how, whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Philip, how can you say, show us the Father? What the Word made flesh, borrowing all the way back from chapter 1, what the Word made flesh here has done is he has made access to God possible. What was formerly impossible. In fact, we have some language in the Old Testament that says something like this. No, you can't look at God because anyone who looks at God dies. But God has come all the way near and has done so carefully that now Jesus is saying to them something that is the opposite of that. No, look straight at me. Look into my eyes and know that what you are seeing, not just the eyes of Jesus, but they are the eyes of God. And if you look closely enough, you will see that the essence of this God is love for you. Love for you. And so, church, we have to be careful that we don't entertain two different visions of God at the same time and employ a different vision of God when it suits us. I would like to ask you to get rid of your thunderbolt God, the one who has tightly clenched in his giant fist thunderbolts used to exclude or destroy even. Jesus seems to be asking us here to look at him and see the Creator God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We'll say it again. We say it all the time around here. If you want to know what God looks like, you really don't have to look any further than Jesus. and the body of Christ. Verse 10, do you not believe that I'm in the Father and that the Father is in me? He's still talking to Philip. He says, the words that I say to you, I don't speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Verse 11, believe me that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me. But if you don't, at least believe me because of the works that you have seen me do. Now, those works, those very cool things that you have seen me do, that demonstrate on a regular basis that love can win and that love will win. Watch this in verse 12. I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact, will do greater works than these because I'm going to the Father. Another way to say it would be like this. Love is about to win the decisive battle that changes all of history. And then after that battle has been decisively won, you get to come along behind me then and implement all of this. And implement all of this. Things will be greater, not because somehow the disciples are intrinsically greater or more powerful, but because they will be implementing a victory already won and will be pushing toward the finish line given this decisive victory that is already won. Verse 13, it gets better. Listen, I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you in my name ask me for anything, when you are dwelling in me and I am in you, when there is oneness between us, because sure enough, I have made space in the very heart of God for all of us to be working together. We're going to hear more of this on Trinity Sunday. When we have this opportunity to not just hear from God, but to participate in God and in the mission of God. When you pray while participating in God, God is moved. God is moved. Resurrection grace embodies a winning love. Resurrection grace embodies the love that always wins. Resurrection grace cannot be separated from love. Now, when I say love, I mean the kind that we see in Christ, the non-scorekeeping, the non-coercive, the selfless, the self-sacrificial love. Resurrection grace and this kind of love can never be separated. So if you see resurrection grace or what you think is resurrection grace, but it lacks that love, it's not resurrection grace. But I can also say it like this. Anywhere you see this kind of love functioning, you are going to see resurrection grace. You've heard it in the Gospel of John. Now hear it from Paul. Paul says it like this. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself, became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. We have this term that Dr. Green actually taught us that has to do with this passage of Scripture. It's called kenosis. Kenosis, self-emptying. And so we have another term that we use that's built out of that, kenotic love. Kenotic love is self-emptying, self-emptying. Now, if you're anything like me, you need to see glimpses of this kind of love. You need to see exemplars of this kind of love. Part of the reason we're asking our photographers to take pictures is because sometimes photographers have the artistic imagination to look in places that people like me would not look for images of hope and grace and love. For example, it was pointed out to me not too long ago, and Jason helped us with this week as well, that this week is National Nurses Week. National Nurses Week. It begins on May 6th. It began on May 6th, and it ends on May 12th. May 12th, which is the birthday of Florence Nightingale. Florence Nightingale was the founder of modern nursing, and she became well known while taking care of the wounded soldiers during the Crimean War. She was dubbed the Lady with the Lamp because of her habit of making rounds at night. I know some nurses who are, this is such a cliche, but they are really burning the candle at both ends, and they are selflessly and sacrificially. Do you realize that thousands of people in the front lines of this virus, people who are medical professionals, have been infected and have died? But there's another good place to look for exemplars of selfless, sacrificial love. Now, Lisa's going to pray this prayer later on. I know not everybody who hears the word mom ends up with a warm feeling. Because for some people, it's been a difficult struggle. And perhaps it's been difficult for a number of reasons. Perhaps it's because you lost your mom. So here we are on Mother's Day, and it feels like anything but a celebration to you. But it might also be a struggle today because you don't have that experience of a mom who loved you sacrificially or selflessly. But many of us do. I would be one of those people. I am blessed to say that for decades and decades and decades, because I'm not just including my own mom, Mama Dorf, all the way in Kansas City, but I'm also including Kelly. I have watched as moms have loved in these same sorts of ways. You ready? Selflessly, sacrificially, non-scorekeeping sorts of ways, non-coercive sorts of ways. Now, perfectly? No, but man, those glimpses give me some idea. Give me some idea of how God loves me. For years, moms have helped people to have some idea of what the warmth of God's love must be like. When I say to you that Jesus is going back to the Father to try to accomplish this giant move whereby there would be room in God's heart for everybody, you can see bits and pieces of that truth in the way that moms go about being moms. Take a look at this video.
When things are at their worst, we can always count on moms to be at their best. While the world around us is hunkered down in fear, they're the ones on the front lines, making the new normal feel a little bit more normal. All in the hopes that years from now, when kids think back on this time, they won't think about the fear or the uncertainty. They'll tell stories about playing ball in the house and not getting in trouble, about epic birthday parades, social distancing dance-offs, and uninterrupted family dinners. They'll remember that while everyone was being homeschooled, they didn't just learn reading, writing, and arithmetic. They learned what really matters in life: love, laughter, and a good internet connection. And during this time when we're all told to stay apart, they'll find that somehow we've all grown a little bit closer. So that one day, when this madness is all finally over, when this new normal goes back to normal, our children will one day tell stories about how in the spring of 2020, the world did not stop. It kept spinning and moving forward, fueled by the most powerful force on earth, a mother's love.
Thank you, moms. No one's expected you to be perfect, but there have been moments we have, because of your love, because of your limitless energy to serve and help and nourish and protect, you have given us glimpses of the love of God. And you have shaped us in ways that have allowed us to turn around and then love people in selfless, sacrificial, non-coercive sorts of ways. Moms out there, forgive us for all the times that we didn't say thank you well enough, for all the times that we didn't live up to the high calling of your love for us. But thank you for forgiving us and then giving us another chance, and by showing us the grace of God by loving us anyway. And now, church, would you join me in a prayer of confession? Prayer of confession before I turn it over to Lisa to pray these prayers of petition and intercession and to pray for moms everywhere. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do confess that we have it within us to be a little bit like Simon Peter, to be a little bit like Thomas, to be a little bit like Philip. All three who had the evidence right in front of them and still somehow were able to miss the essence of love standing immediately in front of them. We too, God, have that same capacity to miss all of the evidence and all the proof that is right there around us all the time. We confess, God, that at times that we can be so self-interested that we are blinded and unable to see all the little ways around us. But there is resurrection grace and resurrection love and hope springing to life around us if we do have eyes to see it. Forgive us, God, for not being grateful when nurses have been sacrificial. Forgive us, God, when we have not been grateful when our moms, over the course of months and years and perhaps decades, forgive us for not being grateful. Forgive us, God, for not being able to see in their love something of your love. Forgive us. We confess that we have fallen short. And yet, even in our falling short, you have demonstrated love. Even in our falling short, moms have demonstrated love for us and have been the embodiment of your grace, your enduring love, and your patience. And so now, church, I want to give you a few moments of silence before I read a concluding word and before I turn it over to Lisa. I want to give you a few moments of silence to pray your own prayer of confession now. Now, as we transition to this next chapter of prayer, let me use these words as your pastor. May the Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
As we transition to a time of intercessory prayer, we want to remember our longtime member, Tina Hughes. She is family to us, and she has fallen, and she's broken her pelvis and a couple ribs, and we want to say a prayer for her right now. Will you bow your heads with me? Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you for Tina. Tina has been so relational to so many of us. She has loved us well. And we want to love her well by lifting her up to you right now and asking that you touch her and heal her. Touch her body. May she heal quickly, Lord. And we place her in your arms. May she feel our love right now. And now, church, we do want to say a prayer for our mothers. This is Mother's Day. I am a mother. A mother of four kids, plus a foster baby who we love. And it brings me much joy to be able to be a mother. So we want to recognize our mothers today, and we want to say a prayer for them. And we also want to recognize those people among us who are hurting on this day and are in a lot of pain. This day brings a lot of memories that are maybe painful to them, or maybe disappointment. And so, will you join me now as we pray? Dear Lord Jesus, our God of relationship, thank you for how you have created the relationship of motherhood. Thank you for the ways in which motherhood changes our life. As a child, it changes our life. Because we feel that love, that unconditional love that comes from you. We thank you, Lord, that we can be in relationship with our mom and know that she loves us no matter what. She's always there to hug us and to pick us up and to love us and to forgive us and to guide us and lead us and teach us so many things about life. Our biggest cheerleader.
our one who will listen to our hopes and dreams, the one who tucks us in at night and reminds us how much we're loved. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being that child that receives that kind of love. We thank you, Lord, for the joy of being a mother, of what that's like to give birth, to give life, to celebrate holding our child close to us, and to be able to speak into that life hope and joy, visions of a future, especially the way we get to speak into our children, a relationship with you. And Lord Jesus, we just thank you for that privilege and that honor. And Lord Jesus, I also want to recognize those that are hurting during this time. I know this can be a very difficult day, either in maybe a loss of a mother, or a loss or broken relationship, or maybe a desire to be a mom and that has not come to fruition. Whatever the situation is, Lord, you know them and you know what they're going through. And I pray, Lord, that they will feel the warmth of your loving arms around them. May they know that you know them and love them and want to bring comfort and healing to them. And Lord, we just give all of this to you. Again, our God of relationship, we love you and we ask this in your name. Amen. And now, guys, we are moving towards our kids' prayers. You will notice the kids' prayers on the screen in front of you. These are prayers that the kids have prayed over this last month. Will you join me in praying with them? And now, Lord, thank you for our kids. Thank you again for the gift of children, the joy that they bring, the ways in which they enliven our life. And Lord, we just thank you for them. They are such a precious gift. They teach us so much how to be all open and honest. And Lord, we love you and praise you for them. And now, church, if you will join me in saying the Lord's Prayer together, using debt and debtors. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Lisa. I'm so grateful to be on your team. Thanks, Pastor John. Thanks, Pastor Tamara. It's been fun to be one of the pastors who gets to be here. And just thanks for some of these cameramen and women. Nicole, who's been on sound each and every week, and Ryan, who's helped us with video. Pastor Zach's kind of been our quarterback. It's fun to be here, to be able to each Friday worship and then allow that worship to go out into the world on Sunday mornings. And so we are so grateful that you have taken the time today to come to worship and participate in this service, not a show, but a service. I see Tamara in the back there too, who's as our worship pastor coordinating things for us. We're so glad that you are taking these moments to be with us as a family of faith at OKC First Church. And one of the things that we do each and every week is we take a moment to give back. And so I'm going to pray again in just a moment for this morning's tithes and offerings. We want to take a moment to say thank you. Thank you for all the ways in which you are being generous and be able to give towards the kingdom and towards this church. We are so grateful for all you are giving out of the abundance of joy in your life. And so thank you, thank you, thank you. Here's a couple of ways in which you can give. And on the screen in front of you, you'll see that little graphic there. It says you can mail in your checks to OKC First Church and that on 4400 Northwest Expressway, an address that means so much to us. And we hope to be able to see you soon back at that physical address soon. Also, most of you are giving online at giving.okcfirst.com. And then many of you are giving by text. And we're grateful for all the ways in which you give. And you can see that number on the screen in front of you and that kind of just kind of short little, if you've never done that before, there's kind of just a little registration process that'll get you, and you can give as often as you like in those ways. We are grateful for your gifts. As you prepare to give those gifts, as we have offertory coming just in a moment, we also want to say thank you for the ways in which you are engaging with us at OKC First Church. And so one of the ways you can do that is by letting us know how we can pray for you. And so would you please this week, if you have a prayer request, please send an email to prayer@okcfirst.com. And we would love to, as a staff, gather those prayer requests together and pray with you as we gather on Zoom throughout the week as a staff. And we'd love to pray for you this week as well. If this is the first time you've watched OKC First Church and you're like, man, I'd like to see what that church is all about, would you let us know by sending an email to info@okcfirst.com? And we'll just send an email back saying, thanks for watching. We're so glad you chose to be a part of our service this morning. And that way we can kind of know who's watching out there, because when we are preaching and singing and worshiping to an empty congregation, we don't really know who's out there. So we would love for you to be able to let us know you watched and participated in the service this morning. Again, thank you for all that you are doing, and thank you for giving back, and let's pray towards that end now. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would draw near to us as in these moments we take a moment to give back unto you. And so, God, would you take all the gifts that are given all over the world in these moments and in the days and weeks to come, for your glory and for the advancement of your kingdom. And would you shape us to be people who are generous? God, we ask that you would especially come alongside of those people who need, God, help financially at this time due to loss of hours or their work or their job. God, would you in this moment, for those who are hurting, bring a sense of your presence, your love, and tangible help in their lives. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Thank you for worshiping with us at OKC First. We are a church that is learning to do three things: friendship with God, friendship with one another, and open friendship for the sake of the world. During these uncertain times when we are not meeting together face to face and we are longing for that time to get together, we want to say thanks for keeping up with the church. And we want to let you know that if you aren't getting those two weekly emails we're sending out every Wednesday and Friday, please let us know. That's the best place you can get information on how to keep connected to the life of the church. And so if you're not getting those emails, please email us at info@okcfirst.com and we'll put you on that list. If you think you're on that list but aren't getting those messages, you might want to check your spam folder. Sometimes those have even gone into my spam folder, and just kind of move it to the inbox and hopefully they'll be able to kind of get you connected. You'll be able to find information about what's going on Wednesday nights. For instance, Pastor John has a book club. He meets once a month, and their book this next month is called Ragamuffin Gospel by Brendan Manning. One of my favorite books of all times, and I think one of the books that has shaped Pastor John's life. So you can start reading that and know when the next date for that book club is. We've had things like, two of our wonderful therapists, Margaret Murray and Beth Wetmore, have been having Zoom calls about anxiety and depression during this global pandemic. They're going to have another one of those. And for the best information about when that's going to be and how to sign up for it, please go to info@okcfirst.com and let us know. And we'll get that information to you through those two weekly emails on Wednesdays and Fridays. So thank you for staying connected. Also in that email, you can find out the specifics of how you can help with our community and our world through this global pandemic. And you've been helping. And so whether it's helping alongside with a Totes and Tees fundraiser for Zambia or bringing by Hope Box supplies, you can find that information in that weekly email. And we're just so glad that you're staying involved, staying connected, and still saving the world. For more information about OKC First, you can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, as well as at okcfirst.com. Thank you for joining us at OKC First. We're so glad you're with us.
Thanks again, everybody, for making this possible. Thank you for joining us today in worship. And moms, thank you for everything that you have done for us over the years. I hope you have a great, great, and memorable, for all the right reasons, Mother's Day. Now receive this benediction. May the God of peace himself sanctify you through and through. And may your spirit, soul, and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls us is faithful, and he will do it. Amen. Go in peace.